Hi, my name is Greg Kareofelas, and I've been asked by the Bohart Museum to share some of my observations of the Gulf Fret during this past year. Unable to travel, I discovered the silver lining of being in my backyard and studying butterflies close to my home. Instead of traveling through Northern California, I found the butterflies in my backyard equally worthy of study and photography. One of my projects became learning more about the Gulf Fritillary. Though both these butterflies share the same common name, Fritillary, one is the California Fritillary and the other is the Gulf Fritillary. You can tell the difference because the silver spots on the Gulf Fritillary are a little bit more elongated and a little bit more shiny, whereas the California Fritillaries tend to have rounder spots and not quite as bright of an orange. Another very important distinction is the California Fritillaries are all found in the mountains and foothills, whereas the Gulf Fritillary can be found throughout the valley and urban areas like Davis, Sacramento, etc. The Gulf Fritillary is more related to the heliconius butterflies shown here from South America. So you may ask, what is a tropical butterfly doing in Davis or California for that matter? The Gulf Fritillary has a long history in California. One of the early butterfly books of California cited the year 1886 is when the butterfly was introduced when a train line was completed between New Orleans and Southern California. Another writer disputed that date because he had found many records of the butterfly flying earlier in 1876 in San Diego. The butterfly has been commonly found along the coast in the Bay Area between 1876 or whatever and more recent times. I use the date 2012 as the important date for me. This was the date it first showed up in my backyard in Davis, California. Like all insects, the butterfly to mate joins tail to tail. And in this configuration, the butterfly is very vulnerable, so usually they're hidden. And I felt very fortunate finding this butterfly in this position, in a position to get this gorgeous photograph of it. As soon as the female has mated, her job is to find the host plant and lay an egg. Sometimes she lays the eggs, and you can see the egg freshly laid. Looks like a little fat ear of corn. Other times they're laid on the leaf. In all instances, the Gulf Fritillary lays eggs individually. It never lays a group of eggs together. This egg showing a brown color tells me that it is close to hatching. As soon as the young larva hatches, its first meal is usually the old egg case. In this way, it gains a few added nutrients, but more importantly, it erases all evidence that there is a little young larva close by. It's now going to look for a spot on the leaf to start eating. As it eats and gets larger, it reaches the limits of the skin that it is in. To grow further, it must shed this old skin. Each time it sheds a skin, it is what is called a new instar. I have been asked, are the spines found on the Gulf Fret larva, are these dangerous to touch? I've never been harmed by touching them, but I find that it is much better to hold the larva like this on a leaf. So this way you're not going to damage it. This is what the larva looks like in its final instar. The red color and spines are to somewhat deter predation from birds. The last color change is this color. This is just prior to making a chrysalis. At this point, the larva is going to attach itself by its tail and hang in this position, which we call the J shape. The next time that this larva sheds its skin, it's going to expose the chrysalis. The chrysalis is a resting stage in which the butterfly is now developing inside. Here you can see the head and the eye, the small wings, and an overly large abdomen. The next step is the butterfly emerging as an adult. Its first job is to pump some of this excess fluid from its abdomen through the veins to expand the wings to that of an adult-sized butterfly. At this point, the wings are still very soft and they must be dried before the butterfly can fly. The final step is for the butterfly to expose its wing to the sun and dry. Much about 5 minutes after I took this picture, the butterfly flew away. Now, if you want to entice these butterflies into your yard, the first step is to provide sources of nectar. In this case, I'm using one of the old-fashioned flowers called Jupiter's Beard. It is true butterfly candy. If you really want to make the butterfly happy, you'll plant passion vine. This is the host plant, the only plant that the larva of the Gulf Rip can eat. There are a number of varieties of passion vine. Some are good, some are not good for the larva. I have found that all of the local nurseries now can tell you which is the best plant to plant if you want to raise caterpillars on your plant. But I want to point out, be prepared that the larvae are going to eat the leaves. This is a large plant growing around my house in East Davis. And towards the end of the year, the caterpillars sometimes have eaten every single green leaf off this plant. But the plant will always survive, and each spring it puts out a new flush of green leaves. One of the benefits also of planting a passion vine is you get a chance to see the gorgeous flowers. They're very unique flowers to the passion vine. Now I have found butterflies landing on this flower, but I've never seen an example that it actually is pollinating the flower or using the flower as a source of nectar. I think the butterfly just happens to perch there sometimes. Now, if you're going to raise a caterpillar, you want to see an example of metamorphosis. If you plant passion vine, the butterfly will find your plant, it will lay eggs, and you will have a chance to see plenty of larvae. But in addition to being able to see an example of metamorphosis, be prepared that many of these larvae are not going to make it to an adult size. Of the hundreds of eggs that an adult butterfly will lay, only two are necessary to reach an adult butterfly stage to maintain a population. Most of these butterfly larvae will be eaten by ants, wasps, flies, sometimes birds. It's an example of what life is like at the bottom of the food chain. The best way, if you really want to be able to see all of the stages of the butterfly, is to actually raise it inside. I use little small salsa containers for the egg and small larva size. And when the larva starts getting bigger, I move it to a larger container. This container is what you would get a McDonald's hot fudge sundae in. And I find out it works perfectly to raise butterflies. Diapause is essentially butterfly hibernation. Diapause is the reason you do not see butterflies in the middle of winter. You only see them in the summertime. So during the winter, all butterflies in some manner are hibernating. Gulf frits, because of their tropical heritage do not have to diapause. In other words, you can see a Gulf Frit essentially any time of the year, and you can find all stages any time of the year. In other words, you can find an egg, a larva, a chrysalis, or an adult butterfly throughout the year. But of course, you're going to see many more of them during the warmer times of the summer and fall. So even if you don't have the ability to plant the plants necessary to attract butterflies or raise butterflies, you now know what a Gulf Frit looks like. And as you walk around town, and if you see a flash of silver with a bright orange upper wing, you're seeing the Gulf Frit.